President Obama must break Washington's silence on Saudi Arabia's human rights record by taking a strong public stand against the systematic violations in the kingdom. That was a call by Amnesty International ahead of Obama's visit to Riyadh, which went unnoticed. Meanwhile, a former American senator has revealed that Washington covered up Saudi involvement in the 9/11 attacks. On this edition of The Debate, we're asking, do human rights come after strategic interests for the US? How can the Saudi-US relationship be defined? Stay with us for more.
Another visit by a US president to Saudi Arabia, Washington's closest ally among Arab governments. Barack Obama's held talks with King Abdullah over regional issues, including Syria, but no talk of what the international rights groups have been complaining about in recent years. That is, the issue of human rights violations by Saudi Arabia. Earlier, Amnesty International called on Obama to raise the issue with Riyadh, but reports coming out of Saudi Arabia suggest the US president, like his predecessors, has ignored the appeal.
The United States takes a double standard approach to Saudi Arabia for one reason: oil. The United States is dependent on oil. As former President George W. Bush said, we are addicted to oil. And as an addict, we will do anything for oil. The United States has killed, we have betrayed people, we have overthrown governments, and we put up with dictatorships like in Bahrain, like in Saudi Arabia.
The Saudi regime stands accused of a range of rights abuses. Riyadh is one of the few world countries which severely punish any form of dissent. Saudi Arabia has harshly cracked down on protests against the regime, which erupted in the kingdom following similar uprisings against the despotic regimes in other parts of the Arab world. Saudi Arabia issued a decree after the protests began that any anti-government gathering will be treated as a crime under the country's law. A number of people have been killed during demonstrations since then. Many activists have also been put in prison, and they've complained of dire conditions in jails. Saudi Arabia's record with regard to women is also very dark. It's the only country in the world which bars women from driving. Some women have defied the law, still the kingdom has refused to lift the ban.
The fact that women cannot drive in Saudi Arabia, the fact that women cannot work in many industries in Saudi Arabia, this is horrendous. The fact that these women that this Saudi princess is complaining about, I've been locked up for 13 years, shows the extent of the oppression in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia.
Saudi Arabia's record on the international scene is dark as well. Riyadh has tried to destabilize other countries, including Syria, and it is the exporter of what many describe as the world's most dangerous extremist ideology, known as Wahhabism. The US has been accused of adopting double standards when it comes to Saudi Arabia. Washington issues annual reports on human rights violations in different countries, but the reports largely keep mum on the situation in Saudi Arabia and its behavior towards other countries. Saudi Arabia, in return, is the US's staunchest ally among Arab states of the Persian Gulf, and it is the main oil supplier to the United States and other Western countries.
You're watching The Debate. Joining us now live from Indiana is editor of Culture Wars online magazine, Mr. E. Michael Jones. And with the Center for American Progress, Mr. Lawrence J. Korb is with us live from Washington. Welcome to The Debate, gentlemen. I'll put my first question to Mr. Korb in Washington. Mr. Korb, while in Riyadh, Obama presented the International Women of Courage Award to Dr. Maha al-Munif, and he said that Dr. al-Munif has been able to pass laws providing protections for women and children for domestic abuse. But the question is, will the U.S. honor those resisting the more oppressive policies of the kingdom at large? Do you think the U.S. is following a selective approach when it comes to human rights issues or democracy in Saudi Arabia?
No, I think it's just the opposite, because a lot of people wanted the president to raise it in private with the king. They had a comparatively short meeting and they had a lot of other subjects to cover. But by presenting this award publicly and giving the speech, some of which you just quoted, I think that sends a much stronger message to the people in Saudi Arabia, to the people in the Middle East, and the people here at home.
Do you think that that award and that speech that Obama made was a positive step forward, showing that Obama is genuinely interested in following up the human rights abuses as reported in the Saudi kingdom? Mr. Jones, go ahead.
Yes. Can you repeat the question?
Yes. The issue of the
award.
Can you
repeat the question?
Yes, yes. The award that Obama gave or presented to one of the leading women activists in Saudi Arabia for her activities, he said, in fighting domestic abuse of children or women. The question was, despite this award being given, do you see this as a genuine approach by Obama in following up the human rights abuses, or do you think that Obama is following a selective approach?
No, I think the whole agenda is shot through with hypocrisy from beginning to end. There's, first of all, the hypocrisy, the double standard of treating the Saudis one way and, let's say, the Iranians another way. But I think a bigger problem is the fact that the human, if you're talking about women's rights, that's hypocritical as well. I was in Cairo in 1994 for the World Population Conference. And there, it was clear that bodies like the United States and the State Department of the United States, the United Nations, I meant, define women's rights as basically abortion, contraception, and they try to disguise these things as reproductive health. So what goes under the name of women's rights is really a form of moral enslavement. So that, I think that's the main hypocrisy that we have to deal with here.
Mr. Korb, you know, the criticism that President Obama is facing is that he refrained from even mentioning or raising the issue of human rights in his meeting with the Saudi king. And that's despite the repeated calls by international bodies like Amnesty International, for instance. You know, and we know on top of all that, the ex-wife of the Saudi king coming out and urging Obama to, and appealing to him to do something about the daughters who've been held captive, in her words, for 13 years. But nothing from Obama. Why?
Well, first of all, this is Obama's second visit to the kingdom. In 2009, he did raise these issues with the Saudi rulers. This time it was a comparatively short meeting, and I think by going public, that sends a much stronger signal than if he had mentioned it in private and nothing happened. And remember, you know, for example, right now, where Mr. Jones mentioned the fact about Iran, we're dealing with Iran right now on nuclear issues. But when our negotiators meet with President Rouhani and his people, they don't raise this. They're focusing on something else. And we don't raise it with Russia when we're talking to Russia about Syria or Ukraine. So you don't raise it every place you go all of the time. And I think, you know, by going public, to me, that sends a much stronger message than if they had sent it in private and then nothing happened.
Mr. Michael Jones in Indiana. Now, you know, the UK-based rights groups Amnesty International said that if President Obama in this visit doesn't raise these issues, and I'll quote here, it would undermine the principles that Washington claims to stand for. I mean, I guess there in Washington, Mr. Korb is saying, why should Obama in a very brief stay in Riyadh raise these issues, which will have no effect? What do you think about that?
Well, I think we have a clear hierarchy of values here. You have women's rights, and then you have geopolitical goals. And whenever it comes to a conflict between the two, geopolitical goals will trump women's rights. It's obvious that that's, women's rights are for conquered people. That's the way we colonize, permanently colonize conquered countries. The best example I can give of this is Paul Wolfowitz arriving in Iraq a week after the fall of Saddam Hussein. What does he do when he comes there? He starts giving money to women's groups, to feminist organizations. This clearly shows that what these people call women's rights is really a form of political control. And it's always going to be trumped by, it's always going to be motivated, any appeal to women's rights is going to be motivated by geopolitical concerns, not the other way around.
And Mr. Korb, you know, in the instance of Saudi Arabia, it's not just women's rights, it is. I mean, 52 lawmakers signing a letter asking Obama to raise with King Abdullah. I'll quote here, Saudi Arabian authorities harassing, intimidating, imprisoning almost all the country's leading independent human rights activists. That letter saying that the government in Saudi Arabia must also end its ban on public gatherings, lift restrictions on social media, stop the use of torture, reform the anti-terror laws, etc. So it's a set of issues there. But even despite the call from US lawmakers, it looks like there's been no action.
Well, again, I think, as Mr. Jones put it very well, every nation balances its national security interests and its values. I mean, if you take a look at the situation in Egypt, we're dealing with Egypt because we see them as a source of stability. When Assad and his father were both running Syria, we dealt with them. And in the first Gulf War, Syria was on our side when we tried to throw Saddam Hussein out of Kuwait. In fact, he sent troops. Similarly, in Kuwait, Kuwait's not a democracy, but the United States-led coalition, which included the Saudis and included the Syrians, a lot of other countries from that part of the world. Iran even helped us in that war to get rid of Kuwait. So yeah, you have to balance these issues all the time. But as I mentioned before, the very fact that he did something publicly to me is much more important than raising this in private and then nothing happening.
Well, Mr. Michael Jones in Indiana, you know, where do the moral lines then lie here? Because if we consider, okay, every country has its own strategic interests, geopolitical interests, but when Saudi Arabia is being accused now and is under fire, for instance, for supporting terrorists in Syria, where is that moral line that should be observed by President Obama or the U.S. administration?
Well, you just hit the nail right on the head. How do you adjudicate competing national interests? Well, there's only one answer to that question, and that's the moral law. So what you have to do is have a policy that is congruent with the moral law so that it can bring about peace in the world. Well, our policy is not congruent with the moral law. I mean, the United States policy is not congruent with the moral law. And when it's just going to be force, and we're going to impose force on the rest of the world, whether they like it or not, you're going to come up with all of these conflicts. And ultimately, you're going to lose your credibility because credibility, as you point out rightly here, is based on moral coherence. If your policy has no moral coherence, you have no credibility, and people just walk away, and you become the enemy of mankind, which is pretty much the position the United States is in right now.
Mm. Mr. Korb, you know, the U.S. has been saying that it's cooperating actually with Saudi Arabia to fight al-Qaeda, but Saudi Arabia is known, especially in the region, for giving weapons and giving all kind of support to terrorist groups who are not just in Syria, but also in Iraq, and in Lebanon, etc. So do you think the U.S. is actually losing moral ground there, as our guest in Indiana is suggesting?
Well, again, if you take a look at Syria, one of the the issues that the president and the king discussed was the fact that they think we, the United States, ought to be doing more in Syria. And we don't want our help to end up going to some of these extremist groups. And that's why we haven't done that. And that's one of the reasons for the trip, because the Saudis are unhappy with a lot of the things that they would like us to do that we're not doing. The Saudis don't want us to negotiate with Iran about their nuclear program. They don't want Iran to be able to maintain, as they can under the non-proliferation treaty, the right to enrich uranium. So we have these differences. In fact, that was the purpose of the visit.
And on that note, Mr. Jones, the Deputy National Security Advisor, Ben Rhodes, has said that coordination with Saudi Arabia on Syria policy, particularly regarding providing assistance to the Syrian insurgents, has improved. How do you think that's improved? Do you think that the United States has agreed now with Saudi Arabia that it is actually going to now more openly and directly start sending weapons to insurgents, as Saudi Arabia has been demanding all this time?
I think that may very well be the case, because what happened in the Ukraine is that the United States offensive to take over the Eurasian landmass was blocked when the Russians annexed the Crimea. And so what you see here now is the reverse of what happened in September. In September, in the aftermath of the poison gas attack, Obama agreed to work with Vladimir Putin, and the neoconservatives, the Israel lobby, was outraged by this collaboration. And it was the neocon, the Israel agent, Victoria Nuland, who orchestrated the coup in Ukraine as a way of opening another front to attack the Eurasian landmass. Now that that's been blocked, I think, unfortunately, what we're going to see now is a resumption of more hostility in Syria.
And Mr. Korb, then, do you think the United States, in order to keep its ally Saudi Arabia pleased, it's prepared now to do what it wasn't prepared to do previously? It said it's not going to send weapons, as you say, for fear that it may fall into the wrong hands, but it's now prepared to do that for the sake of Saudi Arabia.
No, I think what they're prepared to do, as I understand it, is to increase the training. They're going to do 600 people at a time to ensure they're the, if you will, the reasonable people there. They're not extremists. So they still are doing that. And I think it's ironic here with what Mr. Jones said, because Obama's criticized at home for exactly not doing more, not being more involved in a lot of these operations, and for even agreeing with the Russians to try to have a Geneva conference on Syria, which hasn't gotten any place.
And that is a very important question. Mr. Jones, what do you think about that? You know, a lot of media reports were saying that Saudi Arabia is criticizing Obama for, quote, disengaging from the Middle East. Do you think that is the case when it comes to President Obama's policies in the Middle East, that it's actually disengaging, that it's not getting involved?
That was the case. That's why the Israeli lobby and their allies, the Saudis, were infuriated at Obama. I think Obama was brilliant in September by not attacking Syria, by deferring to Vladimir Putin, but he doesn't have the, the moral fortitude to pursue his own policies. He was undermined by a neoconservative holdover from the Bush administration. When she orchestrated that coup d'etat in February, Obama should have gotten on the phone and fired her for undermining his policies. He allowed himself to be stampeded into the Saudi-Israeli anti-Russian camp. And that's just weakness on his part.
Right. We are quickly running out of time. I'd like to raise another issue here that we mentioned at the beginning of the program, and that's one U.S. Senator, Senator Graham, actually accusing the U.S. intelligence agencies of covering up the role of Saudi Arabia in 9/11. I'll go first to Mr. Korb in Washington. Do you think that this happened because of the strong links or, again, those strategic interests involved for the United States?
Well, there's no doubt about the fact that bin Laden was from Saudi Arabia and trained a lot of people, but that does not mean that the Saudis supported. In fact, they kicked bin Laden and a lot of these people out of the country. So there are people who were from Saudi Arabia. In fact, most of the hijackers we know were from Saudi Arabia, but they had been expelled from the country. So I think that's what it is. Obviously, Senator Graham's report is classified, so we haven't been able to read it.
And Mr. Jones, Senator Graham has said that he was shocked when he heard that the 28 pages that were referring to the Saudi role weren't going to be made public was because it would threaten national security. Why do you think they were kept hidden?
I'm suspicious of Senator Graham's motive. Senator Graham is the main representative of the Israel lobby. And I think this is a way of deflecting attention from Israel's role in 9/11. So I'm just very skeptical of this report. You're right.
Yeah.
Bin Laden was involved. He's from the Saudi royal, close to the Saudi royal family. But I'm still skeptical.
Okay, I'm afraid we have run out of time. I'd like to thank our guest editor of Culture Wars Online magazine, Mr. E. Michael Jones, with us live from Indiana, and with the Center for American Progress, Mr. Lawrence J. Korb in Washington. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for being with us on this edition of The Debate. From me, Homa Lizgi. Until our next program, it's goodbye.